Friends, what are the seven links to awakening? The seven Sambuyangas. They are one. The awareness link to awakening. Sati Sambuyanga. Two. The investigation link to awakening. Dhammavichaya Sambuyanga. Three. The energy link to awakening. Virya Sambuyanga. Four. The joy link to awakening. Piti Sambuyanga. Five. The tranquility link to awakening. Pasati Sambuyanga. Six. The concentration link to awakening. Samadhi Sambuyanga. Seven. The equanimity link to awakening. Upekka Sambuyanga. These are the seven links leading to final enlightenment. Freeing from all addiction are these seven links to awakening. The Blessed Buddha once said, Bhikkhus, I do not see even one other single thing that when developed and cultivated leads to the eliminations of the things that bind so effectively and quickly as these seven links to awakening. What seven? One, the awareness link to awakening. Two, the investigation link to awakening. Three, the energy link to awakening. Four, the joy link to awakening. Five, the tranquility link to awakening. Six, the concentration link to awakening. Seven, the equanimity link to awakening. How, Bhikkhus, are these seven links to awakening developed and refined so that they lead to the giving up and letting go of those things that bind? Here, when a Bhikkhu develops these seven links to awakening, joined with and dependent upon seclusion, disillusion, and ceasing, culminating in surrender and release, then these seven links to awakening are refined and matured in a way so that they lead to the leaving of the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. And what are the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess all beings? The eye, ear, nose, mouth, body, and mind are things that addict and obsess all beings. Forms, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and ideas are things that addict and obsess beings. Seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. These are the phenomena that bind, ensnare, entrap, enslave, enchain, and consume beings. Freeing from this addiction are these seven links to awakening indeed. The Blessed Buddha once said, Bhikkhus, I do not see even one other single thing that when developed and cultivated leads to the elimination of the things that bind so effectively and quickly as these seven links to awakening. What seven? One, the awareness link to awakening. Two, the investigation link to awakening. Three, the energy link to awakening. Four, the joy link to awakening. Five, the tranquility link to awakening. Six, the concentration link to awakening. Seven, the equanimity link to awakening. How bhikkhus are these seven links to awakening, developed and refined, so that they lead to the giving up and letting go of those things that bind? Here, when a bhikkhu develops these seven links to awakening, joined with and dependent upon seclusion, dissolution, and ceasing, culminating in surrender and release, then these seven links to awakening are refined and are matured to the leaving of things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. And what are the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings? The eye, ear, nose, mouth, body, and mind are things that addict and obsess beings. Forms, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and ideas are things that addict and obsess beings. Seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. These are the phenomena that bind, ensnare, entrap, enslave, enchain, and consume beings. These seven links that frees from these addictions produce enlightenment. They lead to and induce enlightenment. Thus are they links to awakening. They are themselves enlightened, and this way they are links to awakening. They are enlightened since they embrace the root cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they provide and equip the cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they induce ripening of the cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they enhance the root cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they completely perfect the cause of awakening. How do these seven links to awakening remain established and anchored in the mind? The awareness link remains by no attention being given to other states. The awareness link remains by the sign of being directed to continuously. The awareness link remains by the signless state being given attention. The awareness link remains by no attention given to mental proliferations. The awareness link remains by attention being given to the ceasing of craving. The awareness link to awakening indeed remains fixed and anchored in mind in these five ways. Exactly and similarly so with the other six links to awakening. This is from the Path of Discrimination, the Pasita Sambhita Magga, and the links to awakening.
My beautiful mountain. Knuckles. In the mist. The Cypress Hermitage. On the top, the Palace of Peace. The City of Ease. You're welcome. As soon or even before the meditation hall is finished. Hello to you friends. This is Dhamma on air number 83, recorded on the 23rd November the year 2017 on planet Earth in the Milky Way galaxy. On Sri Lanka, on Knuckles Mountain, just outside the Cypress Hermitage, under the cypress tree. Today are three questions. One, Dhammasala, Bhavanasara meditation hall construction and one meditation course advertisement. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. We first take the meditation hall construction report. We are carrying up the iron, last of the iron today for the fourth wall. Fourth wall, then we need one fifth in the middle to go. Thank you to the supporters and those who help with technical advice. And the construction report comes right here.
Here another little middle station. Because when it starts to rain, then they will usually go down. And it can do any time up here and in Sri Lanka in general. As you see, there's dark clouds out there. I don't think it will rain today. But nevertheless, as soon as they come on here and cool down, because they're pressed up by the mountain, up to a higher layer of air, and then the temperature goes down, and then it starts raining. Middle station 2.
Actually, when working myself on this project of building a meditation hall, I feel a great satisfaction, because I know I do something good for others. And when you do something altruistic, then you also feel a great satisfaction. You are like lighted up by an inner fire and become very happy and satisfied by doing this good. Knowing that many of the donors and many others also, of course, will come and meditate in this meditation hall for the next 20 years, this makes me very happy. So they can approach Nibbana, they can become more free, more happy, more peaceful, and have a greater insight into the absolute nature of reality.
Hello to you, friends. This is just to update you on the meditation hall. The iron has been carried up here, and half of the sand, that's a significant part of the work, is to carry this sand, 35 kilos per bag, up here in 4,000 feet elevation, because there's no road access. Next up is a cement bag, 20 cement bags. So tomorrow we will start to bend these iron rods and make the armament for this wall that will be a part of the foundation, one quarter of the foundation for the meditation hall.
I just like to say then, thanks for your keen attention, clever consideration and kind contribution. We have just started building the meditation hall, which is very necessary because it's raining up here. It's not raining now, drizzling. And I'll make some video, there will come some video about it next week. But donations and support for this meditation roof for meditators that comes up here is very welcome still. And it's this, of course, enables them to approach Nirvana. And when you give somebody else the opportunity to approach Nirvana, then you get the very same thing back from the karmic mirror that reflects this good opportunity giving back to the donor. So this is worth remembering, giving others opportunity to reach deathlessness thereby increases one's probability and ability to gain this very same deathlessness, this very same Nirvana, this very same irreversible end of suffering, this very same lasting happiness oneself. Worth remembering is that Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa.
So much for constructing a meditation hall. They are, of course, no good if no meditators meditate in them. But nevertheless, in order to facilitate this, then I have arranged a meditation course the 18th June, start the 18th June and last to the 13th June 2018 next year. You see an advertisement of it here. You can go to whatbuddhasaid.net and then just click on meditation course 2018 and then the program is there. Those who are interested, they're very welcome to send me an email to be put on the list. The 21st that comes on the list will get the ticket. I'll go through all 40 meditation methods, classic meditation method set forth by the Buddha, and teach in depth on six of them, and then go through all Buddhist history, relation between Buddhism and modern science, here under quantum mechanics and Einsteinian relativity, all teachings and research studies on reincarnation and rebirth, the karmic principle, and a host of other topics that will be taught by both by video and by Dhamma talks. Then we will go to two historical places where there are genuine relics of the Buddha. One will go to the tooth relic place in Kandy, and then we'll go to Mayangana, where there's some hairs and a collarbone. So I can highly recommend coming to this course because it will give one a lift, both insight-wise, meditation-wise, and karmic-wise, because one will have ability to offer to the Lord Buddha's relics twice. Now to the questions. Question 247. Did the Buddha speak about the role and on content of dreams? Can dreams contain memories of past lives? First, the last thing. Can dreams contain memories of past lives? Yes, they can. They can indeed. But so can your awake state. You'll have flashbacks. Just like you have flashbacks of memories in this life, you also have flashbacks from memory from past lives. Usually they are not interpreted as such, whether they occur in dreams or occur in the awake state, or half-dreaming or slumbering. So they can be misinterpreted as fantasies, and they are jumbled up with fantasies and paranoia and all kinds of stray thoughts that has nothing to do with past lives. So it's a very difficult task to disentangle what is genuine past life memories and what is not. However, in all cases, one should not place too much emphasis on this dream material, because one still has to rely on the present and what you do in the present. Whatever happened in the past life, you cannot repair it now. You can do good now, it will modify the echo of the past, but you can only do that if you stay in the present. So it should not be placed too much emphasis, though one can learn something. Regarding what the Buddha spoke about regarding dreams and their significance, then there are two incidents that are classically mentioned. Just before enlightenment, then the Bodhisattva Gautama, he had five dreams. The night when he fell asleep, at the night before he gets his milk rice from Suyata and attain enlightenment, he dreamed five dreams. And these dreams are as follows. First, he sleeps with his head, there will be pictures of it here, with his head sleeping on the whole of India and with using Himalaya as his pillow, with one feet in the Bengali Ocean and other feet in the Indian Ocean. And this was a significance of that was that he will attain supreme, overreaching, unsurpassable enlightenment. The next dream he has that there grew a tree, a creeper up his navel and all the way up to the sky. And this was the significance of that was that he will set forth a noble eightfold way that leads upwards, even out of samsara to nirvana. Then he dreams that white ants with black heads, white worms with black heads and white bodies, they will come and cover him up to his knees. As a significance, he will have many lay followers, which are white-dressed. Then he dreamt that four birds coming from each quarter of different colors, they came to him, and then when these colored birds they landed on his lap, then become all white. And this was a significance of that? Well, he will get disciples from all four castes and from lay and monastic, male and female, and so there are four classes, lay, male and female devotees, and monastic, male and female disciples. Then there appeared to him a large mountain of excrement and urine, where he could walk on without being soiled. And this was a significance of that, but that he will receive extreme many gifts and monasteries and buildings and so on without being attached to them. So he went across this excrement and urine without being soiled by this excrement and urine. And so also in his last life, when he got all these monasteries and power and significance and fame, he was not corrupted by it, not soiled by it. This is a first. So did he place significance in these dreams? Yes, he did. But did he trust him? No. Why do we know he didn't trust him? Because then he got a golden plate by Chiyata with milk rice. And then he set forth this golden plate. He made a test last and say, if this plate, after he'd eaten the milk rice, he put it down in the flood, in the river water. And then if it goes against the stream, and then it went upstream, against the stream, then I will be enlightened today. Then it fell down and landed clink clong on the three other plates from the three former Buddhas before him. And the next Buddha, Buddhist Maitreya's plate will end exactly the same spot. So he tested, he placed significance in the dreams, the five dreams, but he still tested with this test. And then he was confirmed that the dreams was correct, that he will be enlightened today, because there was this miraculous upstream going of, against the stream going of the plate before it sank down. And so also I can recommend looking at these dreams. Well, there is something to be learned. It is information. It's information bubbling out of mind, like a foam bubbling over a cooking pot. But one should not trust it, not trust anything that comes from this wicked mind, this crazy mind. Huh? Not trust anything. Before enlightenment, then one can trust it. Until then one should be very careful not to see the unessential in something that is essential, namely the Four Noble Truths, and then place significance in something that is unessential, namely dream material. Then one will be led astray. Basically, one will become a dream reader. And dream readers are notoriously superstitious and not very good trainees, nor do they have necessarily a very good future. They do the same mistakes that everybody else. Why so? Because they do not reduce their greed, hate, and ignorance by this dream reading practice, whether they do it for themselves or somebody else. Then there's another dream that also I think is very, very beautiful. The Buddha's mother, Queen Mahamaya, on the day of her conception of the Buddha, she has gone to bed, and then she dreamt that the four regent kings, the four great kings, Maharaja, of the next level, the lowest devas, that there are devas, they came and lifted her bed up, one man taking each foot of the bed, and then flew it to Himalaya, where they put it down, and then their wives take them to a lake called Lake Anotata, lying in the back hills of Himalaya, and cleaned her and took her back, and then she fell asleep in this bed. And while she was sleeping in this bed, she dreamt that a huge, large, white elephant with a white lotus in its trunk entered her right side, as you see on the pictures. This was the conception of the Buddha. So, in all cases, you can say there's the dream material on one side, and then you have the historical facts on the other side. It is difficult to connect these dreams with the historical facts. How would you do that? So you can see it is very difficult because these dreams are symbolic of nature, and there's it is imaginary material, information that is projected there up to the screen of consciousness. So it's like interpreting modern art, abstract art. Very difficult. Huh? Often you make mistakes. So even though the dream may be genuine, and it may be point to some fact that can be learned, it can be difficult to learn from them because of the complexity of the dream material. So my own practice regards, if I do something in my dreams, then I will try to classify, why did you do that, this and that. If I was violent in my dreams, I'd say, there's still hate in your mind. It was very greedy, had sex with some other beings in my dreams, then I'd say, there's still greed in your mind. If I ran around being rude or impolite or disrespectful to my teachers or to my parents in my dreams, then I'd say, there's still ignorance in my mind. Because the mind, whether it's dreaming or awake, are exposing, projecting, acting out its mental defilements. So you can learn from it there and get some reminders of what defilement still has to be touched upon. The last thing is that you can be tested. The devas will typically test you in your dreams. They will make test situations, artificial test situations, and then see whether how you react, basically. Whether you react with strong hate, violence, or you react with strong greed. You jump right into the bed with the first sexual object they place, or whether you react with confusion, ignorance, panic, and so on. So they will test you regularly, and this is good to know. When you wake up, did I pass the test or not? And what to do if you didn't pass? What to do about it? Huh? What to do about it? Find the right medicine. That's the deal. So much about dreaming. Question 248. Is it right for a young family to suddenly choose the path of being a monk or nun? What happens to the children when this happens? The Buddha, one Jataka, he and his wife, which was at that time the reincarnation of who actually became his wife in his last life, they went forth both very young. And then he said that as soon as your children can complain about that the food is too salt, it's blameless to go forth. And then usually one should, of course, place the children in a place where they get taken care of them. Usually it's grandparents or uncles or someone else from the family that can take care of them. But otherwise it is blameless, the Buddha said. So yes, it can. A young family can go forth. But it's difficult. I went forth when my son was 7, and that was difficult. That was difficult, both for him and for me and for his mother. And I think this is, in all cases, the Buddha also went forth when his kid was basically within, some say the same night that he was born, but it could be within the first week he went forth. And it's also difficult. It's not because you hate your children you go forth. It's because there is something bigger, greater, more beautiful, and also a way to take care of all children, all beings. To take care of all children, all beings, is far superior to take care of only 2 children or 1 child. Of course, huh? Of course. Though many will blame me. No one will not be blamed. Question 249. How to deal with tension, anxiety, and feeling uneasy? Yes, tension, anxiety, and feeling uneasy. I would say is that can, first one should know that there's the symptoms of 2 things. Either one have done bad and evil in this life and not seen it. So it's a kind of bad consciousness, and is fear of wrongdoing, subconscious fear of wrongdoing, the result of wrongdoing that is coming up from behind. Wrongdoing in this life. And then there can be wrongdoing in a past life that is coming up and will soon flood one from behind like an echo that comes and knock on the door on your back. And suddenly events, very unfortunate events, can be bodily sickness, can be accidents, can be economic ruin, can be disreputation, loss of job, loss, anything unfortunate can happen. Suddenly as a this karmic wave of probability come from behind and runs over one. Usually before this wave hits one in the back, then there will be this anxiety, tension, fear, panic, feeling uneasy. Because the mind has this intuitive understanding that this karmic echo of bad luck, of the result of prior evil karma, is coming up from behind. If it is so, then one has to endure it and repair it if one can see it before the wave hits one. The other one I would say regarding fear, anxiety in general, is to do asupa meditation on skeletons and meditation on corpses. Ideally, one's own skeleton, because it's give fearlessness of death. And when you are fearless of death, then you are fearless of everything. Then the anxiety is gone away. It's evaporate, simply. If there's not only anxiety, but also depression, that is kind of like, mind is moody blue. Not only does it have fear and anxiety, it's also moody blue, suppressed. It has no joy because of this fear. Then you want to do metta meditation on universal friendliness. Universal friendliness that will elevate the mind out of this suppression, this depression, and then it give it gladness again. But irrespective of what it is that is causing this, whether it's in this life or in bad life, one should know it is most likely a karmic response on evil doing. And to identify this evil doing, it is good to meditate. And then often it will be so that if you has attained sufficient calm and sufficient purity, then if you ask yourself, what evil doing did I do in order to feel this and that event now coming up, this anxiety, this fear, this accident, this sickness, whatever, then you will usually see the right thing. It can also be, like in case of dreams, be mixed with paranoia, misunderstandings and so on, confusion. But in many cases there will be glimpses of the right action that you did in your past. And then you have an explanation there. Then you should counteract this. If you killed somebody, you should give life. If you've stolen something, then you should give presents and valuables back to those you've stolen from, but or otherwise in general. If you've been jealous, then you should be rejoicing, and so forth. So to see what was the specific problem and then apply the specific medicine. If one wants to know more about the medicine, wants to have a personal consultation regarding these fairly subtle issues, then you're welcome to contact me. Then we can take a Skype call if it cannot be managed on email. So, fear, tension, anxiety, feeling uneasy. Watch out for the back. A karmic wave coming from your past of your evil doing. Repair it. Repair it so it will not come again. So when it's quelled out, this wave has been exhausted. You've gone through the sickness, you've gone through the economic ruin. Well, then there will be freedom on the other side. And also wisdom, some understanding. Not to do the same evil wrongdoing again. So much for today. Thank you for your advantageous attention. Clever consideration and kind contribution. Lastly, I like to say thank you again and again and again to the kind people who provide monthly amounts to this Hermitage so there can be bought new cameras and audio equipment and whatever is needed. Those who have given food and also to those who provide materials and workforce salaries to the meditation hall. May their merit accumulation explode. Thank you. Namo. Tassu. Bhagavattu. Arahattu. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Anava, and perfectly, perfectly self-enlightened, was the best Buddha. Thank you, and have a nice and noble day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo, Tassa, Bhagavato, Arahato, Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.